Okay, we will now resume, and the question is that Amendment 13 be agreed to, and members should cast their votes now. And that is the vote closed. Point of order, Ivan McKee.
I voted yes.
Thank you, Mr. McKee. I'll ensure that is recorded. Point of order, Katie Clark.
I would have voted yes.
Thank you, Ms. Clark. I'll make sure that is recorded. Just advise you, Ms. Clark, your vote had already registered. Thanks very much indeed. Point of order, Ariane Burgess.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would have voted yes.
Thank you, Ms. Burgess. I will make sure that is recorded. Point of order, Michael Matheson.
Officer, I didn't get a connection. I would have voted against. No.
Thank Sorry, you, voted. Mr. Matheson. I will ensure that is recorded.
Then, officer, I voted yes.
Thank you, Mr. Matheson. I'm going to call point of order, Michelle Thompson.
My connection dropped. I would have voted yes.
Thank you, Ms. Thompson. I'll ensure that vote is recorded. Point of order, Douglas Thompson.
Thank you. Can you clarify with Michael Matheson's vote, whether it was a yes or a no? Because I originally heard no, and I would want to know if you can actually change your vote.
That is not a point of order, Mr. Lumsden, but I can confirm that I accepted Mr. Matheson's clarification of his vote as voting yes. Point of order, Jenny Minto.
Lost connection. I would have voted yes.
Thank you, Ms. Minto. I'll ensure that vote is recorded. And the result of the vote on amendment number 13 in the name of Patrick Harvey is yes 81, no 27. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore agreed. And we now move to Group 6, financial resources to meet emissions reduction targets. I call amendment 14 in the name of Patrick Harvey. Group with amendment 15, I call Patrick Harvey to move amendment 14 and speak to both amendments in the group. Mr. Harvey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Glad everyone's logged in time for this last group, though on this occasion I don't think it's going to do me much good. I want to take members back to the first Climate Act, because in that first Climate Act 15 years ago, I moved an amendment making the case that we needed a degree of scrutiny of the government's budget. Not the carbon budget we're discussing at the moment, but the finance budget, the annual finance budget, needed to be scrutinised with a climate lens. There is a good degree of consensus that we need proper, robust scrutiny of the government's climate action, of everything that it does under the heading of climate action, the climate change plan and so on. But in addition to that, I feel that we need a climate lens brought to the scrutiny that we have of all government action, including all government spending. So I moved an amendment at that point, and the committee at the time agreed, and the government agreed, that there needed to be a carbon assessment of the budget every year. Now, we were debating that at a time when no one had ever done it. No one had ever conducted, in any country, a carbon assessment of their budget. And that was a piece of work that was about innovation. It was about creating a new methodology. And we all acknowledged at the time that that methodology would change and evolve and grow over time, that we were going to learn by doing. And I think that methodology has improved. It does still add some value. But what has always been missing from it is independent scrutiny of the government's budget in climate terms. And that's what I've sought to propose both today and previously at stage two. Now, at stage two, I brought an amendment that the government, I think, quite reasonably objected to, and so did others, on the grounds of timescale, that it wasn't possible in the short time available between the UK government passing a budget, the Scottish government introducing a budget, and then Parliament passing it. Within that short timescale, it wouldn't be possible to independently scrutinise the government's budget in climate terms and to have that given to Parliament. So what I'm suggesting now is that instead of doing it within the budget process, we set a later date within each financial year, and I'm suggesting that we align it with the end of May or the period just before the summer recess. That's the timescale on which the government has an agreement that in normal circumstances it will present the medium-term financial strategy. Now, it's not to say that it should form part of that medium-term financial strategy. It will still be looking at a 1 year's budget and asking, is it adequately funding the action necessary to be compatible with the carbon budget? But climate action works over a longer timescale, and so does the government's medium-term financial strategy. At that moment, at that fiscal event, if we like, the Parliament will be asking those longer-term questions. Are we heading in the right direction, and are we going to achieve what we're setting out to do? And I think the independent nature of finance scrutiny that's missing is the key issue. The Scottish Fiscal Commission, which I would consider to be the appropriate body to carry out that independent assessment, gave evidence at stage one to the committee on this bill. Graham Roy said, and I quote, "Nothing in the annual fiscal budget says, for example, what we're spending on net zero. So how can you have a bill that says what our ambition is and what progress we're making on the targets if you're not able to trace that through to whether the government's spending is consistent with that? Is it overachieving, overambitious, or underachieving? That's one piece of the jigsaw that has been missing. And it remains missing. I think Parliament's scrutiny, both of the budget and of wider climate action, would be stronger and better informed if the budget was subject to independent scrutiny in the same way that other aspects of the government's fiscal policy are subject to independent scrutiny. We pass tax resolutions through Parliament, but they are first assessed. The government's tax policy is first assessed by a body with the appropriate fiscal expertise, the Scottish Fiscal Commission, to tell us whether that tax policy is going to generate the revenue that the government expects it to. We would not be in a position to make those decisions as Parliament in a well-informed way if it was not for that independent scrutiny. And that's what I'm seeking to add in relation to the connection between the fiscal budget and the carbon budget. And the last thing I want to say, Presiding Officer, is that I expect the government will argue that this would imply somehow that only the Scottish Government's budget is relevant to the investment and spending that we need on reaching the carbon budget. Of course it isn't. Every level of government, UK government, Scottish government, local government, have a role to play. Private investment, both by companies and by individuals and households, have a role to play in redirecting our entire economy toward a net zero ambition. But as Parliament, we have a responsibility to scrutinise, in just a moment, we have a responsibility to scrutinise the government's budget as they present it. And that scrutiny of the budget needs to be well informed in terms of its alignment with what the government says it wants to achieve on climate action as the contribution that it's making to compliance with the carbon budget. I give way.
Douglas Lumsden.
I thank Patrick Harvey for taking the intervention. I was just following what he was saying. And on that basis, would you also expect local government, when they're setting their budget then, to actually have regard to the Scottish Government's carbon budget?
Patrick Harvey.
I would urge them to do so. I would urge them to do so. But we're passing legislation here, and I'm suggesting that we consider our responsibilities as Parliament in the decisions that we make. We don't scrutinise and pass or reject local government budgets. It's for councils to do that. Our job is to scrutinise and pass or reject the Scottish Government's budget, and that task will be better informed if we require the Scottish Government to scrutinise, to have independent scrutiny brought to bear by a body with the appropriate fiscal expertise, and I have in mind the Fiscal Commission. And I think what I'm suggesting is very much in line with the evidence that the Commission itself brought at stage one. So I look forward to hearing what the government has to say. I don't expect them at the moment to be supporting this, but I do hope that they recognise that, as Graham Roy said, there is a piece of the jigsaw that is missing. And if this isn't the solution, I'd be interested to know what the government thinks is the solution. And I move that amendment.
Thank you, Mr Harvey. And I call Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. So I'm grateful to Patrick Harvey. I think he will recognise it. We tried to be quite open-minded at stage two and asked some questions to get clarity. And I think while we're sympathetic to the members' aims, and I think 14 and 15 are alternatives to one another, is that correct? Still not fully persuaded by the amendments. When we discussed it with the government last week, I think there was a willingness to go away and look at what Patrick Harvey was trying to achieve, see if something could be done. So, you know, I'll listen to the Cabinet Secretary in a moment, hopefully. But I think, as Patrick Harvey probably knows, we're not yet fully persuaded. But I'd be interested to know if there are other measures out of the bill that the government could look at that would help to achieve the aims. I think the points that Patrick Harvey's made around the important connection between the fiscal budget and the carbon budget, I think that's an important point. And Patrick Harvey knows anything that will improve scrutiny and alignment, we agree with. But I'm just not convinced, and I think the fact he's got two different amendments, I'm not sure Patrick Harvey's fully convinced either, but I look forward to hearing what... happy to give way.
Patrick Harvey.
I'm grateful to the member reminding me. I should have said in my opening remarks that the alignment with the medium-term financial strategy is what I'm aiming at. But that document hasn't happened every year, and so I'm offering two alternatives. One specifically says alignment with that strategy. The other sets a specific date rather than that strategy being referenced. I think the preference would be the first of the amendments that we're going to vote on. That would be my preference. But either option, I think, would be a viable one to enable the Parliament to have the information before it that it needs and in time for in-year budget revisions to address the concerns that were raised.
Monica Lennon.
Thank you. I'm grateful to Patrick Harvey for that further clarification. I'll just repeat the point that I made. For Scottish Labour, we're still not persuaded. Happy to listen to the Cabinet Secretary, but I think it's unlikely we can support this as drafted.
Thank you. I call Bob Dorris.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Just very briefly, Presiding Officer, I actually think Patrick Harvey's doing Parliament a service by bringing forward these amendments. You won't be surprised that I'm not be supporting them, but Mr Harvey's points towards the end of his contribution around that there's lots of moving parts in relation to the financial commitment needed to meet net zero commitments, not just the Scottish Government budget, but the UK Government, local authorities, private sector investment, businesses themselves, consumers. Consumers are going to have to face a burden in relation to all of this. And I'm not sure whether Amendment 14 is intended to get some independent scrutiny that the Scottish Government's fiscal budget will meet the entirety of its contribution towards net zero, because those moving parts means the private sector investment is larger, perhaps the Scottish Government contribution can decrease. If the UK meet their responsibilities, perhaps there will be more money at play for the Scottish Government to meet its net zero commitments. So I'm not quite sure how Amendment 14 fulfils the role that Mr Harvey wishes it to do so, but I think there is a merit in having this conversation within Parliament.
Patrick Harvey.
I'm grateful to Bob Doris for giving way. I hope he recognises that in any one financial year, and I'm suggesting that we examine each year's fiscal budget in isolation, in any one financial year, we will be very aware of what the context is. What is UK government policy? What kind of changes have been made in terms of the private sector investment that's being brought to bear? And it does need to play a role in reaching net zero. We have to consider each year's fiscal budget in its own terms already, in the wider context of how the rest of our economy is shaping up. And the connection with climate, the connection with our emissions trajectory, in that context is no different.
Bob Doris.
I thank Mr Harvey for the intervention. I take his points on board, but Mr Harvey talks about 1 year's budget. The Scottish Government will, if this legislation is passed, will effectively produce 3 5-year carbon budgets over a 15-year period. That goes far beyond 1 year, and is predicting what private investment might look like in 5 years' time and 10 years' time. And to boil it down to 1 year's financial budget, with the moving parts of UK government investment, what businesses pay, what private sector will pay, what local authorities will pay, what consumers will pay, I think is not the way forward. But the reason I made this contribution, President Officer, and I'll finish here, is I think it is important for the Scottish Government to be clear where there is a funding gap to meet net zero ambitions. And that funding gap isn't necessarily a funding gap from the Scottish Government, but between the UK Government, Scottish Government, local authorities, private sector investment, consumers and businesses and many others, I'm sure, Presiding Officer, we have to identify what the gap may be, but that gap is not always the responsibility of the Scottish Government, and I'll leave it at that, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I now call the Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. So I've listened to interest with what Mr Harvey has said, and we've had discussions with this. I agree with Bob Doris, it's very important to discuss this, because it is important that we give as much information as possible about, you know, as Bob Doris says, any funding gaps, but also the carbon assessment of how the government spends its money. Now, I mentioned in stage two that there is a piece of work being done. It's been piloted at the moment to actually look at how the spend of the Scottish Government relates to our net zero ambitions, and indeed the carbon associated with it, the emissions associated with it. So I agree that there's work in train, but there's also potentially more work to do in designing and implementing a process that will provide meaningful information in how government spending decisions support meeting emissions reduction targets. And trying to tie that process down in legislation, I don't think is the right way to do this. I think a couple of things. I think we need to see how the pilot is rolled out and assess how effective that has been. And I'm very open to discussing these issues further with Patrick Harvey and indeed the committee in general. But as we all know, budget processes are both established, complicated, and there are some fundamental problems with these amendments. First of all, we know that funding for our policies to deliver carbon budgets will come from across our economy. Bob Doris made that point, Mother Colenna made that point in stage two as well, including from the private sector, not just from Scottish Government. That crucial point is not reflected in these amendments. Indeed, when they refer to the financial resources being made available, it is unclear, as they are drafted, whose financial resources they refer to. So it would mean that any such document could only be partial in setting out the resources required to meet carbon budgets. The formulation of Amendment 14 calls for information about the resources needed to ensure a carbon budget target is met by providing the information with medium-term financial strategies covering at least 5 years. Now, that may seem to make sense because carbon budgets will typically cover 5-year periods, but the amendment also says that the information is to be provided only in relation to the financial year in which the report is laid before Parliament, rather than require information about resources needed throughout the whole period that is covered by the strategy. So I think it's confusing and will result, I think, in even less understanding of the resourcing of emissions reductions. But I do think there's work to be done, and I'm happy to do that work.
I'm grateful.
Thank you. I'd call Patrick Harvey to wind up. Press a withdrawal amendment 14.
Oh, I thought I was intervening, President.
Oh, you're intervening. Oh, I'd call Patrick Harvey to intervene then.
Thank you. I'm grateful to the Minister for giving way. Clearly, we disagree about some of the objections that she's raising, but the Minister talks about the pilot. And I would like to know whether she is in a position to give an explicit commitment that the work the government is currently developing will be subject to external, independent scrutiny, whether by a body like the Fiscal Commission or some other independent body with the appropriate expertise. Because there are issues where the government's own marking of its own homework, if you like, will be appropriate, and there'll be other circumstances where it's not. There'll be situations where parliamentary scrutiny is appropriate, and there'll be issues where it becomes a little bit of a political football. And it's that independent scrutiny which, to my mind, is the critical missing piece of the puzzle. So is the government in a position to give that explicit commitment that what it's developing will be subject to independent scrutiny?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think it's a really good point, and I take the point about independent scrutiny of what we're doing. At the moment, that pilot is an internal process. So, first of all, we want to embed that in the work that we're doing, but obviously I'm sitting beside the Finance Secretary at the moment. It's a discussion that she and I have to have around this and what would be appropriate in that area. But I give Patrick Harvey the commitment that we'll look into it, because I think his points are well made. Amendment 15, I just want to wind up talking about Amendment 15. It suggests that there should be a statement in each financial year about what resources have been made available in that 1 year to meet that multi-year carbon budget, which I think is impractical, could lead to information presented in a confusing way, which is an issue that's been mentioned by Bob Doris. I agree, though, this is an area in which improvement is needed. I've set out some ways in both in stage two and now about some of the work that the government is doing, but I take on Patrick Harvey's point. I think it's been a useful debate to have, but unfortunately the government can't support amendments 14 and 15.
Thank you. Second time of asking. I call Patrick Harvey to wind up. Press to withdraw. Amendment 14, Mr Harvey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Well, I'm grateful to members who've contributed to discussion on this. I'm sorry that we're not going to, as it seems, be in a position to make a change to the legislation on this occasion to achieve what I'm looking for. I think just to very briefly respond on a couple of the points. Yes, of course, the spending set out in the Scottish Government's fiscal budget each year is not the only thing that will contribute to the spending and investment necessary to make the transition to net zero and to align Scotland's path with the carbon budget. Many other sources of funding and investment, including the private sector and the UK government, are critical. But that's not unique to climate. That happens in pretty much every other policy area. If the government sets an objective in the field of health, for example, the achievement of that objective will be partly dependent on health spending, on the investment that the government makes through its own budget into the NHS and the services that are necessary. But the achievement of that objective will also be set by a whole host of other factors that affect public health, from individual behaviour through to the behaviour of corporations in terms of the goods and products that they sell, and other changes that are happening in our economy as well. Poverty and inequality will impact directly on health. That doesn't mean that we shouldn't set long-term objectives for health in government policy, and it doesn't mean that we don't need to scrutinise each year's budget. Is the budget contributing what is necessary to help keep us on track with those government policies? So in that sense, climate is not different from other areas where we do expect to scrutinise the government's budget in terms of its ability to deliver on government policies. Presiding Officer, I will press the first of these amendments, Amendment 14, to a vote simply in order to register the concerns that I've raised, and I hope that in time the government will accept the need to close this missing area of scrutiny, to fill in what Graham Roy described as the missing jigsaw piece, and to ensure that budgets are subject to independent scrutiny with a climate lens. I press Amendment 14.
Thank you, Mr Harvey. The question is that Amendment 14 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
Parliament's not agreed. There'll be a division, and members should cast their votes now. And the vote's now closed. Point of order, Faisal Chowdhury.
Sorry, I couldn't get connected. I would have voted no.
Thank you, Mr. Chowdhury. I'll make sure that's recorded. And the result of the vote on Amendment number 14 in the name of Patrick Harvey is yes 7, no 102. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call Amendment 15 in the name of Patrick Harvey. Already debated with Amendment 14. Patrick Harvey, to move or not move?
Not moved.
That is not moved, and that ends consideration of amendments. At this point, as members will be aware, the presiding officer is required under standing orders to decide whether or not, in her view, any provision of the bill relates to a protected subject matter, that is, whether it modifies the electoral system and franchise for Scottish parliamentary elections. In the case of this bill, in the presiding officer's view, no provision of the Climate Change Emissions Reduction Target Scotland bill relates to a prohibited protected subject matter. Therefore, the bill does not require a supermajority to be passed at stage three. There will now be a brief pause before we move on to the next item of business.
Thank you. The next item of business is the Stage 3 debate on Motion 15168 in the name of Gillian Martin on the Climate Change Emissions Reduction Targets Scotland Bill. I would invite those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the Request to Speak buttons, and I call on Gillian Martin, Cabinet Secretary, to speak to and to move the motion. Up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I open this debate, first of all, by thanking colleagues from across the Chamber who have contributed to this bill. And we have done so in the spirit of reaching consensus. I think there are some in the Chamber today who, over the last couple of weeks, who were in my office as much as their own. I think that engagement has paid off. I think it is a better bill as a result. And we have shown that by working together, we can achieve the changes that we want to see through discussion. I believe we've worked together because we're all aware that we can only achieve our shared aim of reaching net zero by working together. I think in the Stage 1 debate I said something along the lines of, we're tremendously lucky in this Parliament that every single party who's represented here believes that climate change is a real and present danger to our human safety, our environment, That is not the case in every parliament. You know, there are no climate deniers here, and I think that's a thing that we should be proud of. That spirit of collaboration was present for the... Yes?
Patrick Harvey.
I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary, I said Minister earlier, for giving way. It's an interesting point that she makes, and it's one that I reflected on when we debated the first climate legislation. We had a competition at stage three for the most ambitious amendments that people could make to raise the... Every single political party was seeking to make that bill stronger. And there are climate deniers here. They just know that they're not allowed to say so openly because those opinions are not given the space that they are in other countries. That didn't help us, though, did it? That fact didn't keep us on track with the ambition that was set. And I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary would like to reflect on why.
Cabinet Secretary.
So Patrick Harvey makes a point that I was going to move on to, and that is the fact that it's not enough to set targets. It's not enough to state your ambition, that you have to be working together in the way that we have all worked together in this bill. We have to be working together on the action required. Now, that's a lot more difficult than what we've done today. Today is looking at how we're measuring and how we're taking on advice from the Committee for Climate Change. But one thing that we do know is that some of the things that are options in order to reach net zero are going to be things that are going to be challenging and difficult. And anyone who voted in the 2019 bill, which set the very ambitious targets which we missed, we need to reflect on why we missed them and what was not done in order to achieve them. And again today, I mean, I'm very much at the words of Rosanna Cunningham ringing in my ears that this is, it's not enough to set targets, you have to vote for the action. But more than that, Mr Harvey, everyone in this chamber, it's incumbent on all of us to come forward with their ideas as to how we think we can accelerate action as well in a way that is just and indeed, you know, some of the comments we had about where the government spend is, you know, in your own in the party's own proposals around the budget, we have to recognise that we've also set very challenging net zero targets as well. So every time that we come to this chamber with measures which will reduce emissions, we need to bear in mind the responsibility that we have to ramp up action. And that would be my reflection on that. I'm grateful for members for providing scrutiny and advice under considerable time constraints. I also want to record my appreciation for the committee in facilitating my accelerated timetable. It was not easy, and I know that, and I want to thank the clerks and the members of the committee, and indeed the work of Spice colleagues who were supporting members as well. I'm grateful to the many stakeholders and individuals who also reacted to that timescale as well and provided their views and expertise. I want to also thank my private office staff who have been major support to me, and indeed my heartfelt thanks go to my bill team who are sitting at the back of the chamber for the hard work, support and expertise during the progression of the bill and facilitating helping other members across the chamber in drafting the amendments that they have. And I hope that everybody gets a well-deserved rest after today, but not for too long, because, of course, we have got the very important piece of work to do in terms of actually putting our climate change plan together. Presiding Officer, I will.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful for the Cabinet Secretary to take an intervention. Can I ask what lessons the Scottish Government can learn, particularly with regard to what frankly was a timetabling crisis in respect of this matter, because of the concerns over the previous dates that were set into statute that would have occasioned a potential breach of the law?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think what I would say is that we need to look at how other countries have put their targets in place and reflect that Scotland maybe, the Scottish Parliament maybe gave us targets on the face of a bill that put us in that position. No other UK Parliament did that. They always gave themselves the flexibility. And I think it's a double-edged sword, because on the one hand, you want to show ambition, but it's not enough to show ambition. You have to have the action associated with that. You have to take other things into account that might happen. Pandemics. We didn't see that coming. You know, we also have inflation and the economy, economic situation, which also has an impact as well. There's also the things that happen out with our borders as well. You know, the Russian illegal war with Ukraine, for example, has an impact as well. So I think other governments and other parliaments have not put themselves in that position. And hopefully what we're doing today will keep our foot in the pedal with regard to the action, but the climate change plan, where that's really at, but also won't put us in a position where we break the law. So I think that we need to really reflect on that as a parliament, as how we went across, how we went. But some of the measures that people have actually put in this bill to have more information when carbon budgets are going to be agreed, I think are going to be very helpful in that respect. So I just want to go through some of the things that have been a success. I think we have achievements in terms of actually reducing our emissions. You know, our tree planting stats are 75% of all new woodland planted in the UK last year. We've halved the emissions, in fact, more than half the emissions associated with energy in this country, and electricity in particular. We have put a raft of policies in place, but the fact is they're not enough. They're not enough. But also, Scotland can't be siloed. We have to work together. It's not just working together within the UK, but working together across the whole of Europe as well. I want the best way forward is always where we're looking at where we can do what we can in the devolved space, but also looking what we can do as a partner with other parliaments and governments across the UK on some of the shared things that are have an impact on all our ambitions. I'd like everyone in this chamber to bear in mind that it's all of us collectively need to get behind the action associated with net zero as well, and that's working with other governments, working with our constituents, understanding the fears that they might have around some of the things that need to get to net zero, and having that social contract with people on what we need to do to get us there in a just and fair way. So the bill itself would establish a carbon budget to target setting, moving from linear annual targets to a set limit on the amount of greenhouse gases emitted in Scotland. And the expert advice of the Climate Change Committee will be taken into account when we make those decisions in secondary legislation. This change will help us to account for in-year fluctuations like harsher winters, support us to put in place strategic and fair long-term plans. The bill would also enable these carbon budgets to be set through the secondary legislation, as I said, using the expert advice from the CCC. If approved, the bill will lay the foundations for the next steps we must take to reach net zero by 2045, and will present 5-year carbon budgets to take us to 2045 as well. Right now, after this has passed, and I hope it will pass, we will urgently seek advice from the CCC on setting the levels within the 5-year carbon budgets, and we will bring forward regulations, and that will be the next step in this process. But throughout this process, the climate change plan is working, it's been worked on as well, because we know that some of the decisions that we're going to have to make for that, the action to follow the setting of those carbon budgets.
Cabinet Secretary, I appreciate you very generous in terms of taking interventions, but could you please bring...
We've learnt a great deal about how our target system operates and how it might work better, but we must now put that experience into practice. And I move that the Parliament agrees that the Climate Change Emissions Reduction Target Scotland Bill be passed. Thank you.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I now call on Douglas Lumsden to open on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And thanks to the committee and the devolved government who have worked together to make significant improvements to the bill. There has been true collaboration, and credit where credit is due. I commend the government's approach to this bill. They have worked with opposition parties to improve amendments, but also importantly, explained and discussed why some amendments were unworkable. And I guess that's why we were at stage three with only 15 amendments to consider and only 2 votes. It's now at a point where the Scottish Conservatives can support, but of course this is just the start and tough choices will have to be made in the future. More needs to be done to reach net zero, and we'll continue to hold the Scottish Government's feet to the fire on this hugely important issue of climate change and our journey to net zero. We must continue to hold their feet to the fire, Presiding Officer, because their record in this area has not been a great one. This devolved government has failed to meet its climate change targets, has failed to address the challenges that we are facing, and failed to set out a clear plan on how together we can achieve net zero. The stage one report from the committee did not pull its punches in terms of how this bill needed to improve, and myself, fellow committee members and other MSPs and the Cabinet Secretary have worked hard to ensure that some of the concerns of the committee were addressed. And I thank the Cabinet Secretary for taking on board some of those concerns and including them in the bill. I said in the stage one that debate that this issue is too important, too big, too vital and of too great significance to rush it through without adequate thought and thorough examination. And I still feel this is the case and would have welcomed more time to work with colleagues on this issue. However, we are where we are and we must move forward. There are welcome improvements following stage two, and I think that it's worth reflecting on some of that here. I thank my colleagues, Graeme Simpson and Maurice Golden, for their helpful amendments on requiring the Scottish Government to share an indication of what policies and proposals might be included in the next climate change plan, and the requirements for a cost-benefit analysis to be published for the period covered by a Scottish carbon budget. Importantly, a further amendment from Maurice Golden requires the Scottish Government to assess whether the carbon budget will be met. An area where we didn't manage to agree was on the issue of alignment. The majority of evidence we heard in committee supported alignment with the UK carbon budget. And I feel it was disappointing that the Scottish Government didn't go down that road, but I'm sure we can make it work. And I know that Northern Ireland have aligned, but Wales do not. So I fully accept there were arguments on both sides of that debate. The amendments which have been agreed through the passage of the bill, I feel, have strengthened the bill, particularly in terms of accountability. Something that's badly needed within this SNP government, who have so failed Scotland and our green industry in past years. Failed in achieving its key climate change targets in 9 out of 13 years. Set to fail in 4 out of their 6 recycling targets for 2025. Failed to publish its draft climate change plan. And during the Stage 1 debate, I expressed concern that having this new bill will mean nothing if the devolved government don't follow up with actions. The energy strategy is a prime example. We were told... Of course.
Cabinet Secretary.
Would he accept that part of that future success is going to have the same kind of approach to our climate change plan that we've had with this bill, that all the parties in here need to come forward with their ideas and collaborate on what a climate change plan is going to look like?
Douglas Lumsden.
I absolutely agree. I think the way that this bill has been handled compared to the circular economy bill, for example, has been chalk and cheese. And I think we've all benefited from that. And I think we've got a much stronger bill at the end of this process. The energy strategy, I was saying, was a prime example where we were told it's been imminent for months now, but we still have no sign of it. During Stage 1, I asked the Cabinet Secretary to intervene and tell us when it will be released. I repeat that invitation just now, if the Cabinet Secretary can tell us when it will be here.
So, as I said before, it was only a few weeks ago that it's going to go through Cabinet first, but it's imminent. But it only was a couple of weeks ago that I said that.
Douglas Lumsden.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that intervention, but this is the problem. We've been told it's been imminent and ready. We were told it was delayed because of the general election and requires Cabinet sign-off. But the Cabinet meets every Tuesday, we are told. So, you know, what are we still waiting for? Because industry are waiting for this, waiting for the direction of travel, waiting for the certainty, but instead it seems to be kicked down the road while jobs in the North East are lost. The Scottish Conservatives welcome this bill as a step on the way, but more should and must be done. And we need to see a draft climate change plan as soon as possible after the Climate Change Committee delivers their report next spring. Presiding Officer, this party wants to see a new independent office for net zero that would work with and scrutinise public bodies in their progress to net zero. We would establish a national centre for green jobs based in the North East and with a manager that lived in the North East of Scotland. Thought that I would just clarify that for our Labour colleagues who thinks that GB Energy should be based in Aberdeen but managed by someone 350 miles away in Manchester. The Scottish Conservatives want to continue Scotland's role at the forefront of energy, and of course we support a transition for our oil and gas sector, not the cliff edge that they are currently facing with this devolved Scottish Government and Labour in Westminster. Presiding Officer, we support this bill as a step along the way, but more must be done to bring us to net zero, and difficult choices lie ahead. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Lumsden. I now call on Monica Lennon to open on behalf of Scottish Labour. Up to 5 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to speak today on behalf of Scottish Labour. And before I speak about the bill and the amendments that we've passed today, which in large respect are technical, I think it's important to put on record our sympathies and thoughts with the hundreds of people in Spain who've lost their lives, the dead, the missing, the families left behind, and those on the front line of that emergency who are risking their lives to save others. I think the scenes that we've seen in recent days are frankly unbelievable. They're really difficult to witness. So as we talk about these issues today, I think we are all reminded that the climate emergency isn't happening far away, isn't a tomorrow problem, it's a right now problem, and it really is a matter of life or death. So I'm pleased that we have the chance today to talk about our shared passions on how we tackle the climate and nature emergency, but I think we have very real reminders in real time that we can't just talk we do need action. And I don't think it's a shortage of ideas that's brought us to where we are today with this bill. I think across this Parliament, we have colleagues on all benches who are very passionate about addressing the climate and nature emergency, but it's action that we need. And it's bold action we need. It's radical action. It does need to have finance behind it. So in terms of the bill, like other Scottish Labour, we are frustrated that we're at this point today because we'd much rather be talking about the climate change plan and all the other exciting projects that we need to see. And we know it's not all going to be easy in plain sailing. We know there will be debate about some of the actions that need to happen. But that's where we need to get to. So we've been very clear that our approach to this bill was going to be based on being constructive, trying to find consensus, because the bill was narrow in scope for good reason. We brought some amendments to strengthen it, to improve it. I think we managed to do that. And we've worked with other colleagues on their amendments. Even when we couldn't support them, you know, we were always looking to find some common ground. But when you look at the briefings that we've received for today's debate from stakeholders, including from WWF, from Friends of the Earth Scotland and the Stop Climate Chaos Scotland organisation, people share that frustration. People are frustrated, they're a bit fed up, and they really want to see progress being made. So Scottish Labour will continue to work with the Scottish Government, and I think without embarrassing the Cabinet Secretary too much, it has been quite refreshing to work with Gillian Martin and her officials. I think I know Gillian Martin's cushions and office interior better than I know my own, because we've all been in and out. It's been like a revolving door in recent weeks, and I think we're all a bit exhausted because the committee and other colleagues, we've worked really hard around the clock. And I think it's important to recognise the effort of government officials, but also officials here in Parliament. And it's not ideal to have to work at that pace, because we want to have proper time to consider proposals and ideas. But I think where we've got to today in terms of the Stage 2 and Stage 3 process, we've got to a good place. But hopefully we'll continue to have that dialogue and that consensus and try and find the common ground. But I do hear what colleagues are saying about the issues that remain unknown, the bills and the strategies and plans that we still have to see. And I know they don't all sit with the Cabinet Secretary. So I suppose it's a hint to government as a whole that this needs to be an absolute top priority. That's why we need to see progress on the Heat and Buildings Bill. We need that final energy strategy and just transition plan. We need that action plan to reduce car kilometres by 20% by the end of the decade. We need support for our rural communities. And I think the opportunity here is huge, Presiding Officer, because in closing, if we get the action right and if we make progress, the gains are not just for the environment, it's for our economy and it's for our communities. This is an environmental, economic and social imperative. And as I said at the start of my opening remarks, it is a matter of life and death for people and planet. So we will support the bill at Stage 3, and I look forward to working with the government and colleagues in the months ahead.
Thank you, Ms Lennon. I now call on Patrick Harvey to open on behalf of the Scottish Greens. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I first of all genuinely pay tribute to Monica Lennon for making the choice to open her speech recognising what we actually mean when we use jargon phrases like the climate emergency. This is here and now. This is life and death. And I think Monica Lennon was quite right to remind us of that. Throughout this afternoon's proceedings, I've been struck by, and I think a bit upset by, the extraordinary gulf between the atmosphere in the chamber today and the atmosphere when we debated the first climate bill 15 years ago. A huge demonstration outside this building showing the anger, the urgency, but also the optimism and the determination of a whole host of civil society organisations that brought together a climate movement in Scotland that was more powerful than any political party, more powerful than the government at that time, because that is what forced every political party in Parliament into what I described earlier, a race to bring more ambitious, more constructive, bolder amendments to strengthen the bill during its passage. And that's why we ended up with the ambitious climate targets. Well, they felt ambitious at the time, those original climate targets 15 years ago. I think the atmosphere in the chamber today of us, for the most part, kind of nodding through technical amendments to a framework legislation, a piece of framework legislation, tells us something about how we really feel about this bill. I think we're a bit embarrassed by this bill, and I think we should be a bit embarrassed by the need for this bill. The first two climate acts were statements of bold ambition, and this one is an admission of failure. And I think we need to own up to that. I think we need to own that collectively. And that failure is largely a result of political choices that have been made. Because even when we were debating that first bold set of targets and racing for amendments to strengthen that bill, government was equally happy to celebrate a road building programme, legislation to unravel road pricing legislation that had been set in the first session of the Scottish Parliament was being blocked and unravelled. A whole host of other policy choices were not being made in a way that was consistent with that bold ambition on climate targets. So what have we got in this bill shifting from one legislative framework to another? Multi-year carbon budgets? Fine. Okay. I'll accept that the intention behind annual targets of achieving annual accountability and making that more likely that government would stick to a plan, that didn't work. Multi-year budgets, fine. This bill includes accountability. It's not perfect, particularly in relation to the budget issues I raised earlier. But the problem isn't what's in this bill. The problem is what's missing at the moment. And that is the context of urgent policy action. I don't expect a full climate change plan right now, but I do expect urgency. And we see the assessment of the A96 stalled, sitting on ministers' desks unpublished. The Energy Strategy and Just Transition Plan stalled. The 20% car kilometre reduction target, nothing happening there. Progress on rail fares and on nature restoration in reverse. And this week we find out as well that the government is confirming significant job cuts in the Heat and Buildings programme. Without that Heat and Buildings programme, there is no credible climate change plan, and there can't be one. If there's time in hand...
Briefly, Cabinet Secretary.
I just want to say to Patrick Harvey that there are not going to be cuts to the Home Energy Scotland. I think that maybe I need to clarify that. That's a continuing programme.
Patrick Harvey.
Well, we'll certainly explore that. The government quote in response to the Scotsman article seemed to suggest otherwise. Look, the question fundamentally is how we are to have any confidence in a new framework. It's not enough just to pass that framework, just as it was not enough to pass the original framework and the original climate targets. We need to have confidence, and it's only policy context. It's only the context of immediate action now, not waiting for climate change committee advice, not waiting for the carbon budgets, not waiting for the climate change plan, but taking action now on the issues that are already stalled. It's only that that would give us confidence that this new framework will actually be effective. And if it isn't, I fear that we'll be in a repeating cycle. And we simply don't have time to waste on that.
Thank you, Mr Harvey. And I now call on Lee MacArthur to open on behalf of the Scottish Liberal Democrats. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I apologise firstly to Patrick Harvey for having to briefly step out at the very start of his contribution? Can I, like others, commend the Net Zero Committee members, indeed witnesses, clerks and others, for the work that they carried out in a very truncated timeframe? And since the Stage 1 debate, I think what we've seen is an impressive, fairly intensive amount of work carried out in a collaborative approach, which again is very much been the tenor and tone of the debate through the amendments this afternoon. I certainly welcome that, and I think I would like, as others have done, acknowledge the part that the Cabinet Secretary has played in that. I wouldn't suggest that I spent more time in her office than mine. In fact, I think in the last meeting I had with her, she gave me the wrong office number, so was clearly trying to divert me to one of her colleagues. But nevertheless, I think that approach is very much to be welcomed. But I think, as Monica Lennon said, this is an issue in the here and the now. So where do we go from here? I think a bit of context is necessary. There has, to my mind, been a bit of historical revisionism, again, less in today's debate. And again, I would exclude the Cabinet Secretary, whose candour on this has been, I think, pretty exemplary. But there has been a suggestion that, in a sense, Parliament set the government up to fail. Yes, the targets set in the previous Climate Change Act were challenging, but the UKCCC made clear they were achievable. And indeed, former First Ministers and Ministers were very, very quick to talk about the world-leading climate change legislation passed by the Scottish Parliament and pioneered by the Scottish Government. There were no caveats there about, but we've got no idea how we're going to achieve it. But again, Patrick Harvey and the Cabinet Secretary were right. The target setting has always been the easy bit. I think it was Chris Stark that referred to it as the sugar rush phase. But Chris Stark headed a UKCCC who were clear that this was stretching but achievable, subject to the appropriate actions from both Scottish, UK government and others. But they repeatedly and consistently warned about the lack of action plans coming forward. So it wasn't that Parliament was rejecting these action plans. The action plans themselves were never seen to be credible by the UKCCC. The blame invariably lay elsewhere, and we've got to move away from that approach. Again, I would acknowledge the way in which the Cabinet Secretary has gone about piloting this important legislation through Parliament. In terms of the bill itself, I think the carbon budgeting framework is an appropriate way forward. I think that the lack of alignment with UK budget, I'm more relaxed about, recognising, I think, as most members did, that there are pros and cons in different approaches. But the flexibility that it provides is one that we can take advantage of. But I think it does now require us to have that laser-like focus on the climate change plan and the other actions that will lead to delivery of those ambitions. And the final point I want to make is around the transparency and scrutiny. That has been the weakness up until now. The detail is absolutely integral to any chance we have of hitting these targets, and that has been the weakness up until now. It is going to be vital for Parliament's scrutiny role, but I think it's going to be vital for the stakeholders out with this building who have a role and involvement in that process. I think Mark Ruskell made some important points around his amendments earlier on in relation to the point about consensus. But, Presiding Officer, we are here today. This bill itself is a reflection of failure, and we cannot afford to find ourselves in that position today. Today has been, I think, and the handling of this bill provides cause for optimism, but we have all acknowledged, or all speakers in this debate have acknowledged so far, that the hard work, the tough decisions are yet to come. Scottish Liberal Democrats are committed to playing our part in that process and look forward to voting for this bill at decision time this evening. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr MacArthur. We now move to the open debate, speeches of around 4 minutes, and I call Michael Matheson to be followed by Graeme Simpson. Mr Matheson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I think, like a number of speakers in the debate so far, and I suspect in the Cabinet Secretary's position as well, is that we prefer not to be in a position where this piece of legislation was required. But we have reached a point where, as the Committee on Climate Change have said, is that our 2030 target is no longer achievable within the existing timeframe and the policy options available to us. And now in this legislation, I believe, gives us a good opportunity to reset the framework which will drive us forward to achieving our net zero target by 2045. And I do believe that the carbon budgeting method which has been set out in this budget has been enhanced by the scrutiny of Parliament and is in a stronger place now than when it was introduced into Parliament. But I believe it gives us a better and a stronger framework to make sure there's greater stability around how we manage achieving our net zero targets going forward. because one of the problems was, I think, with the target levels that we'd set in the face of the bill is that it didn't give much scope for flexibility and some of the variations that will inevitably occur over a particular time frame. But I do agree with Patrick Harvey in that the key issue here will be not so much the framework in itself, but it's actually the policy options which we pursue in order to make sure we deliver on the framework which is set out in this bill. And as I said in the Stage 1 debate, the low-hanging fruit is well and truly gone. We are now in a position where we will have to make some very significant and challenging decisions in order to make sure that we're able to deliver on what this legislation is intended to achieve. And while I accept across this chamber there is a consensus on the need for us to achieve net zero, I believe there is a consensus across the chamber, certainly a majority, who believe that we need to achieve net zero given the imperative nature of the impact that climate change is now having on our environment, as we can see in some parts of the world just now, for example, in Spain, as Monica Lennon made reference to. It is critical that we continue to move at pace in these areas. But there's a couple of areas which I think are really important and we need to give focus to in going forward. In order to achieve net zero here in Scotland and to do so in the time frame which we have set, it will require fiscal stability around the areas of investment that will be necessary in order to make that happen. That requires the UK government to continue to make sure that they are investing in net zero in order to allow capital investment to be made here in Scotland in areas that will help us to achieve that. So, for example, one of our big emitters is around energy and housing. We require capital in order to make that happen, public and private capital, and critical to achieving that will be the approach that the UK government takes. So we will need to see joint working between governments and fiscal stability to allow that long-term planning to be implemented and taken forward effectively. Another big area we will require to see change in is behaviour change. Monica Lennon made reference to the 20 kilometres, the reduction of 20% in car journeys. In order to achieve that, that's going to require behaviour change. And in order to do that, it's going to require a change in how we, for example, use things like road tax. Do we shift away from fuel duty and road tax, which are based on the idea of carbon emissions, to one which is based on road tolling? Because some would argue that's the approach that you should take because that will have an impact on people's behaviour. But to achieve that, you would require agreement across the UK to make it work effectively. So while we might say in Scotland it's the right thing to do, in reality it might be difficult to achieve because the UK government aren't prepared to pursue that. I'm happy to give way to Monica Lennon.
Briefly, Ms Lennon.
On the point of behaviour change, I think, is always an important and interesting one. Does the member also recognise that it's very, very difficult for people in Scotland to shift away from car and use public transport when there are big areas in our country where there's just no bus to get on, or it doesn't come when you need it? That's something that's been really deteriorating. We've discussed it a lot in committee. Bus deserts emerging in Scotland, even though people have a bus pass if they're 22 and under or over 60. Does the member agree we need to really get serious about that?
Michael Matheson?
Yeah, look, I don't disagree with that. However, what I'm saying is that it will also require political leadership across the whole of the UK in order to achieve some of these targets. And that will require us to make decisions that may at times prove not to be popular. But it means right across this chamber, in the Scottish Parliament, at local authority level and also at UK level, we will require the right political leadership in order to make sure the policies that will deliver the outcomes that we need are able to be delivered. And that will require us all to work collectively. I'm conscious of time, Deputy Presiding Officer, but I do believe the bill is in a stronger position now than when it entered into Parliament. And I do believe that the framework which has been set out by the government in this bill is one which will deliver net zero by 2045 with the right policies alongside it in order to achieve that.
Thank you, Mr Matheson. I now call Graeme Simpson, who is joining us remotely, to be followed by Katie Clark. Mr Simpson.
Thanks very much, Presiding Officer. I hope to make a brief contribution. I know that will be popular with members. We're in this position today for being asked to pass a bill that should not have been necessary if the government had done its job. And Patrick Harvey called it an embarrassment. He was right. He called it an admission of failure. He was right about that as well. We're really being asked to dig the government out of a legislative hole. As WWF said, quotes, "The need for this bill is frustrating, but makes the best of a bad situation. We need to see action from government that will put our climate and nature ambitions back on track." Now, we have this bill because the government failed to meet legally binding climate change targets or to produce a draft climate change plan by the end of this month, despite having promised to have it ready over a year ago. And that's why this bill has been rushed through. The government was unable to abide by the law, so it's had to change the law. Members are well aware of the background to all this. I don't need to go over it, but we've had a series of missed targets. Friends of the Earth Scotland said in their briefing, the 2030 target set by the 2019 Climate Change Act was ambitious but completely achievable. And they went on, the need to amend the targets now is solely down to Scottish Government inaction. They're right about that. And they call for urgent and radical action taken now, or the 2045 target will not be met. Now, I, like others, welcome the constructive approach taken by the Cabinet Secretary in working with us and others at stages 2 and 3. I suspect myself and Douglas Lumsden haven't been in her office quite as often as Monica Lennon, but we are super efficient, myself and Mr. Lumsden. I have to say, and I agree with Douglas Lumsden on this, the approach was in marked contrast to our experience during the passing of the Circular Economy Bill. This bill is better for that collaboration. Now, you know, we've had a number of amendments at stage 2 and 3. I think they've improved the bill, but the test will be whether it makes any difference at all to people's lives. And that we don't know, because that requires plans and policies which are missing. So we need to see the Heat and Buildings Bill. We need to see, as others have said, a plan to cut car miles, if that's what the government's ambition is still, or they should just stop pretending that it is. None of this will be easy. Let's hope there's more collaboration when it comes to doing the hard stuff. And, Presiding Officer, I'm happy to support the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Simpson, and I now call Katie Clark. Ms. Clark.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I welcome this opportunity to speak in this Stage 3 debate. I welcome the work of the committee and the amendments to the bill, which I believe have strengthened the legislation. But, of course, it's more than disappointing that we're having this debate today and that the targets, which were previously set in law, will not be achieved. I thought the Minister made her case in a very reasonable way, but we have to accept that we will all suffer as a result of the failures to take action, not just here in Scotland, but across the UK and indeed across the world. As Monica Lennon said, we only need to look at the dreadful scenes we have seen in Valencia this week to see the potential consequences of our failure to act. While it may be hard to draw direct links between climate change and individual events, these kind of extreme weather events will become more common and more disruptive to our daily lives. And as these weather events become more common, as we are already seeing, it will become clear that it's not just about isolated weather events that cause so much damage, but the ongoing effect of a new climate on our interconnected world. Climate change is not just a shocking event elsewhere, but a global process that will affect all of us, from disasters to everyday increases in the price of food and disruption to supply chains. It's therefore very difficult to put a financial cost on what that means. We need to take action in many areas, such as reducing our reliance on oil and gas and this requires serious work. So, as I say, it's very disappointing that the government have missed 9 out of its 13 targets and 8 in the past 12 years. And we need to recognise that many environmental activists in particular are both angry and shocked by the decision to move away from the targets which were set. As politicians, however, I think we need to accept that those targets simply are not going to come into effect now, and that there has been a lack of ambition across our political institutions and a failure to grapple with the magnitude of the crisis we are facing. As Patrick Harvey said, we are going backwards in many policy areas, and that many of the actions required to meet the kind of targets that we discuss in this chamber are simply not happening. So I will support this bill today, as I think it recognises where we are, and I hope that it will be a starting point for more of the real action that needs to be taken, and that we see the depth of the climate crisis for what it is, a process that will change how we need to organise our society, from how we transport goods and how we produce energy to the food we eat and how we travel. There is a need for fundamental change to how we manage the emissions and the economy more broadly if we are to have a livable planet. Climate change is not happening in another country. Climate change affects us all. And in this Parliament, we need to work collectively to show leadership. We need to work cross-party, and we need to work together to match the warm words of politicians, the warm words of government, with action. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Clark. We will now move to closing speeches. I call on Mark Muscoe to close on behalf of the Scottish Greens. Around 4 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can I join other members in thanking the clerks, Spice and witnesses who really helped us to deal with what has been an incredibly rushed parliamentary process for this bill. But can I also thank the Cabinet Secretary and her officials for a very constructive engagement, particularly over the last couple of weeks, as we've been trying to make sense of bringing forward amendments to this bill and what time that we had available. Now, we are 5 years on from the declaration of a climate emergency in this Parliament. We're 15 years on from the setting of those first and important targets. But I think, you know, there has been a failure here, a failure to really take action and to take early action to meet those targets. So when the Cabinet Secretary talks about there being a consensus in this Parliament about the importance of climate change, a consensus that has existed around the targets, yes, there has, but there has not been a consensus around the immediacy and the importance of the action that is needed to tackle this crisis. And that's what we need to build on going forward. I think there's the emergence of a beginning of an understanding in this debate here today about the failure of the action that has not come forward, but we need to move forward on that. I'm really stuck for time, unfortunately, Mr. Doris. Importantly, what this bill doesn't do is erase the 2045 net zero target. That remains effectively as the North Star which we're aiming towards. But of course, what it does do by removing the 2030 and 2040 targets is it makes that pathway to net zero a lot steeper. And of course, there's been a failure to take early action, which could have ensured that we're on a smoother pathway to 2045. That has not happened. Yeah. We have not met the 2030 target, the 75% by 2030. And I agree with Katie Clark, that's left many people shocked and angry that opportunity to take early action was not taken. So it's going to get a lot harder. It's going to have to ramp up. Now, what this bill does, it is a narrow technical bill, and it does provide Parliament effectively with a stronger role going forward. So with carbon budgets, we'll get a better opportunity to scrutinise that. We'll get a better sight of what policies government is going to bring forward to back up its budget early on. There will be a climate change plan that I think will finally follow the budget pretty quickly. There'll be more public engagement on the back of that. If government fails to meet targets, there'll be better catch-up reports in more detail. There'll be a stronger link to CCC advice as well. So all of these things are good things for the job of Parliament to actually scrutinise the Scottish Government. But there's still missing elements here. It's disappointing that Patrick Harvey's amendments on financial budgets didn't pass, because we had great evidence from the Scottish Fiscal Commission. It's clear that there's a critical role there in terms of independent scrutiny. As Michael Masterson said, we need to now get into a position of fiscal stability between the governments. There needs to be a serious central commitment to delivering on climate change ambition, and that needs to be funded by all governments. What we have, and what the Cabinet Secretary talked about, was a commitment to a net zero test. That's important for the government's own internal thinking about financial budgets, but we do need to see that independent scrutiny going forward. Presiding Officer, I think many members have reflected on the failure of policy. We have seen continually one step forward and then two steps backwards on climate policy. So with the Energy Strategy Just Transition Plan, we are looking for that to come out soon and for it to deal with some of the contradictions here. The fact that carbon capture and storage is still an uncertain technology. The fact that Peterhead Power Station will lock us in to using gas for decades and decades to come. We need to see certainty on the A96. We need to see an ambitious heat and building strategy. We need to see road traffic demand management, which, yes, I agree with Michael Matheson, needs to include road tolling. It needs to include road pricing. As part of that, we need an honest conversation about that. But, Presiding Officer, to conclude, I'm sure this bill will pass at decision time, and members may be tempted to applaud that. The Greens will not be applauding. We'll be abstaining on this bill, because this bill is an admission of failure. The only way forward is to double down on the action that is desperately needed to tackle this emergency, and we all have a responsibility to do that in the years ahead.
Thank you, Mr Ruscoe. I now call on Martin Whitfield to close on behalf of Scottish Labour. Around 4 minutes, please.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and it's a pleasure to close on behalf of Scottish Labour at the end of what has been an interesting Stage 3 and Stage 3 debate. I would like to start by thanking the committee, the clerks, and all of those that have supported the advocates and politicians with regard to the timetabling with regard to this bill. And I'd also like to thank my colleague Sarah Boyack, who apologises for being unable to be here, but it was due to a commitment that couldn't be moved. I would like to spend the short time that I have by looking at how we got here, but not in respect of the long term over the past decade or so, but actually into the events that happened with regard to this legislation, and in particular to the timetabling and the expectations that were placed on this Parliament, on the committee, by the Scottish Government. And I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her response to my intervention in the opening of this, because I think it does show an insight into where there is a challenge in the perception between the Scottish Government and the Parliament. But before I deal with that, can I first also put on record my thanks to the Cabinet Secretary to what has been a sea change in the approach with members of this Parliament, both within the Scottish Government's own party, but also within parties across this chamber, and the very much open-door approach that was taken. Now, a cynical person may have said that was in part due to the timetabling, but I like to think that the experience has shown that with an openness to cross-party ideas, to solutions, to allow those strategies that exist within this Parliament to not necessarily reach consensus, but to improve amendments, to take both sides' points of view and see the challenges. There is a way through that in this case has had to be expedited because of the timetabling in respect of the bill. But I think to echo a view from mostly around this chamber, we have a much better bill now than it began with, even though there are clearly members around this chamber who are going to be unable to fully support but not object to it. I think the Parliament and the Scottish Government can learn from the past 6-7 weeks that there is a different way of doing policy. And I think to echo contributions from around the chamber, this very narrow bill is just the start. It is a measure of a certain failure by the Parliament and the Scottish Government. But there is a plan that shows that by opening up, by having the discussions, and when we look at the climate plan that needs to come forward, I think there are opportunities to try and reach consensus across this chamber, because that is important, because I think to echo almost every speech, now is the time for action. It cannot wait any longer. There are strengths in the system that we have within this Parliament, and I think we should use those strengths to bring forward policy and planning decisions that people outside of this Parliament can see, can contribute to, can build into, so that when it comes back to this Parliament, we can if not quite speaking with one voice, speak with a substantial majority to say there are very hard decisions that have to be taken, but those decisions can be taken and there is a strength of agreement around the following. But that has to come first and foremost from the Scottish Government in leadership. And we've heard examples of where over the past decade or so there have been failings. I could go into that, but I think there is no value in doing that. I think the opportunity is, having backed ourselves out of a cul-de-sac, let's look at the roundabout of opportunity that sits in front of us, draw on that, and make the future a brighter one for, as Patrick Harvey said, those many hundreds, nay, small numbers of thousands that turned up a decade and a half ago to celebrate the climate bill. And let's re-establish that enthusiasm, not because people are despairing, but because they see an opportunity actually for a different future. I'm grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Whitfield. I now call on Edward Mountain to close on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives, and I would advise Mr. Mountain that I can continue to be generous as we still do have some time in hand. Mr. Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I fear you might not need to be, but your generosity is always gratefully received. I'm going to start off just by closing and saying we need to remind ourselves why we are here today. We're here today to discuss a climate change bill because we failed to reach our targets. Challenging targets they might have been, but they were achievable. And to blame anyone else but the government for failing to reach these targets, I think, is wrong. Now, we came here to discuss a bill that was talked about in May, but not released to the committee till September. And whilst I understand the committee and the clerks and everyone worked very hard to get this through the various stages, Cabinet Secretary, it would have been helpful if the bill had been released when it was first talked about. It would have meant that further evidence could have been gathered during the period between May and now, which would have allowed the committee to take a more informed opinion. I personally am disappointed that the committee, despite the amount of time that amount of times it asked the government for information on the bill, was rebuffed at every turn. But so we are. That's where we are. So we were given, as a committee, a very tight and pressurised timescale to look at this bill, with Stage 2 only being discussed on Tuesday, shortly after recess, with amendments being lodged during recess, and Stage 3 amendments having to be lodged by Friday lunchtime. I think that's hardly an acceptable way to do legislation when we could have done it in a much more considered way. Now, I find myself at this stage perhaps agreeing with, well, not perhaps, but agreeing with Patrick Harvey. It is a sad day. It's a sad day because we've now accepted that the targets that we've set ourselves as a parliament will not be achieved. And that is sad news. But I do, however, believe there are some benefits that carbon budgeting, I think, will give us a better way to achieve our net zero targets. My other sadness, I guess, is that this Parliament has decided that it is not appropriate to align with the UK when it comes to carbon budgets. Experience has taught me in my life that if you try to rush ahead of what everyone else is doing, then it invariably means that it's going to cost you more. You're going to be using newer technology, which probably won't last the pace that you require it to do. Now, in concluding, Presiding Officer, I'd like to congratulate everyone on working together because I think we all have. But we had to work together because this government was in danger of breaking a law that had been set by the Scottish Parliament. We are where we are. I look forward to receiving the climate change plan when it arrives and the carbon budgets, and I hope that the government will expedite these as soon as they have had the advice from the Climate Change Committee, and that the committee, if I'm still on it, has given further and more thoughtful consideration of these targets by having more time to do so. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Mountain. And I now call on Cabinet Secretary Gillian Martin to close on behalf of the Scottish Government. And there is continuing to be generosity in the time available. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Effectively, I'll just talk until you tell me to stop, because there's obviously a lot of points that were made in the closing debate, most of which I really want to try and address. I won't go over what the bill has done. I did that in my opening speech. We're all so familiar with what it actually achieves. And it just achieves a change in mechanisms to set our carbon budgets and to assess our carbon budgets and to assess the information or to look at the information that is required by the whole of this Parliament before we make those decisions on what goes into our climate change plan and the ambitions that we set. And I've been reflecting an awful lot on 2019 when we set the targets, the interim target of 75% reduction in particular, because that was always the target that was the most challenging. Nobody likes to fail. I don't like to fail. Nobody here likes to fail. We wanted to be in a position where we would reach that 75% target. But we were told by a lot of people how difficult that would be. And I remember Monica Lennon's just been to Iceland to the Arctic Circle Conference, and I had gone to the Arctic Circle Conference just after we had set the 2019 targets, and I told the then Environment Minister, we were sitting and having a bilateral with him, and he's a climate specialist, and I mentioned 75% of greenhouse gas emissions by 2030, and he, I mean, genuinely nearly fell off his chair. In fact, he actually used some quite fruity language, which I won't put on the record as to it. And he said, how are you going to do that? How are you going to do that? And I've never forgotten that. But I don't feel that setting a target that people are critical of and say you're not going to do is in itself a bad thing. Because it has accelerated action. We just haven't met that particular target. It is a source of great regret to everyone. Would it would be in the case that we had met it. But it was always extremely challenging. And Patrick Harvey has made a great point that I've heard made by many others, that if we set targets, it's not enough to pat yourself on the back that you're going around the whole of the world telling people how great you are because you've set a target. Big deal. You have to collectively, within the Parliament, collaborate on the ways in which you are going to get there. But more than that, you have to be able to articulate that to the people that we represent, because none of this is going to be easy and none of it is going to be cheap. And I think Michael Matheson made a point there about fiscal sustainability around this. You know, we're talking about heating buildings and decarbonising heating buildings. Why have we still got a system where the country of the UK that is producing the most green energy of all four nations, in fact a great deal more than any other countries in the EU, is still having most of its homes heated by gas? Why? Because it is cheaper to heat your home with gas. So even somebody like myself, Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero, then Minister for Climate Action, is confronted with a situation where her own home, she needs to replace her boiler. And she phones around trying, my house isn't suitable for a heat pump. And I am told at every turn that putting in electric heating is going to be the most ridiculous and stupid thing that you can do. So we need reform of markets in order to recognise that we are an electricity producing country, that we're a green electricity producing country. And that's one area in which I am very pleased to say that I am having collaborative discussions with the new UK government on. Also, the four nations approach, I meet regularly with Hugh Aranci-Davies from the Welsh Government, with Andrew Muir from the Northern Irish Assembly, and with my counterparts in the UK Government around this. We need to recognise that there has to be fundamental market change and systems change to do the big stuff. But the big stuff is expensive stuff. And we have to recognise that we're going to have to communicate that to our constituents and get their buy-in for the necessity. Now, I don't want to get into anything that's going to point any fingers. I think there's enough of that goes on in the climate change debate. We're all responsible for this. We're all responsible for the action that is required in order to deliver climate change. It's not one government, it's not another government, it's not local authorities, it's all of us individually and collectively. I'll take Monica Lennon.
Monica Lennon.
I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary giving way. I think it's important we don't leave here today giving the impression that this is just too difficult, because I think it wasn't the targets that were the problem, it was the lack of action. But the Cabinet Secretary has had a lot of compliments today about her approach to being very open to colleagues. But I just wonder if she could say to Chamber today what lessons the Scottish Government has learned. Because if we're going to make the progress that we need to make, we need to see the leadership and the collective action across government. So the First Minister's now in his seat, and I just wonder if we're able to get a few words of comfort today that the Government has learned lessons, because we're here today because this has to be a wake-up call. So interested to hear.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, you know, the First Minister has four priorities, and net zero is one of them. But that's obviously something that his government has decided to prioritise. What I was going on to say is that at the moment there are things that are happening in order to decarbonise the whole of the UK, and there are ambitions around that. But I sense that when sometimes you go out and speak to your constituents, some of the things that are happening can look unpalatable. Transmission infrastructure, developments. We have to have a situation where communities feel that they are getting something out of them. And this is another area in which I am working with the other governments in the UK to make sure that the communities that are hosting developments and infrastructure around energy in particular feel the benefit of that. That's another thing that needs fixed. The other thing that needs fixed is there can be no one-size-fits-all to any kind of interventions in this space. I heard a lot about car use, and obviously I work very closely with the Transport Minister and everything that she does. I work closely with a lot of government ministers because it doesn't just sit within this portfolio. It is not one-size-fits-all. What works in Glasgow will not work in New Pit Sligo. You know, if I were to drop somebody there and tell them that they could get to their work in Aberdeen with it, you know, by public transport, people would laugh you out of town, you know. So there's a different approach. We have to recognise that in some areas it is not feasible to not use a car. So we need to look at the systems that are available for them to use a car, but a car that is lower emissions, etc. There's lots of things. I just want to mention some of the contributions, if I have time, Presiding Officer. I want to associate myself with Monica Lennon's comments about Valencia. Valencia could have been anywhere, could have been us. It could have been any city in the whole. Flash floods are a real and present danger. They are a result of climate change. My heart goes out to what people are suffering there. We have had forest fires in the Arctic. We have had extreme weather events in this country as well. Douglas Lumsden rightly points out in the bill in particular that a lot of the amendments are about sharing more information so that we all have everything at our fingertips to be able to make these decisions. I understand Patrick Harvey's frustration around this. But again, I want to point to the fact that Scotland is a very different geographical area, depending on where you are. So not every intervention is going to work in Glasgow, that's going to work in Shetland, that is going to work in the Northern Isles. So we need to look at the just transition element associated with this. Michael Matheson talked about the policy options that we've pursued about being significant and challenging. But there are also a lot of them are going to require us to recognise that they are going to need an enormous amount of funding. And that funding cannot just come from government. We also have to put more pressure on the people that operate within our countries as well, in the private sector. They have got a massive role to play in this as well. And I just want to say one thing in response to Graeme Simpson. I've enjoyed working with Graeme Simpson on this bill for his pragmatic approach. But I'm not so keen on the finger pointing, and I would actually, you know, I'll hold my hands up and say we have not met the 75% target, but we can't keep on looking back, and we can't just start apportioning blame, because meeting net zero is the responsibility of each and every one of us that's in here. It's what you do in your own life, it's what you say to your constituents, it's what you vote for in this chamber. And that's the message that I really want to leave people with. When we bring forward our climate change plan, and when we give all the information out to people about the potential routes we can take, there will be some stuff in there that is going to make you hold your breath. wow, we can't do that. How's that going to go down in my constituency? How are we going to afford to pay that, the cost associated with that? But we're all going to have to look at the art of the possible here. That's the most important thing that comes next. So next time in this chamber, and we've brought something forward, I think we all have to remember what was said here today in this chamber about the ambition being only the kind of ritual signalling part of this. It's the difficult action that we all need to get behind. So I want to thank members for their work in this bill. I'm just about to wind up, but if the presiding officer lets me.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, presiding officer, and to the Cabinet Secretary. And it is in the weeks before that, before the Cabinet Secretary comes to this chamber to announce that, that the work needs to happen if you're going to seek agreement across this chamber.
Cabinet Secretary.
Pretty much that's where I was going to end, Mr Whitfield. In the same way that I have an open door approach, and I appreciate the comments about my lovely cushions in my office, more of you can come and see those cushions and spend time in my office, where we talk about what we collectively need to do within this Parliament to get us to net zero at 2045. I look forward to those conversations, I look forward to those suggestions, and I look forward to us all taking responsibility to getting to net zero. I want to thank all the members for their work and their bill. We have done a job of work. We have ruined quite a lot of October recesses, but we have got there, and I thank everyone for their cooperation with me and my team. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the Stage 3 debate on the Climate Change Emissions Reduction Targets Scotland Bill. It is now time to move on to the next item of business, and I'm minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 11.2.4 of Standing Orders that decision time be brought forward to now, and I invite the Minister for Parliamentary Business to move the motion.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, and the question is that decision time be brought forward to now. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
There is one question to be put as a result of today's business. The question is that motion 15168 in the name of Gillian Martin on the Climate Change Emissions Reduction Targets Scotland Bill be agreed. And as this is a motion to pass the bill at stage three, the question must be decided by division. And as there have been votes throughout the afternoon, I will allow a few moments for members to refresh their apps. Thank you.